Hi everyone. In this video, I will go over everything you need to know in order to master the garrison shipyard, from introducing you to the basic concepts to leveling up your fleet and optimizing it for gear and gold. Since we're covering a relatively large topic today, I decided to divide the video into chapters. The first one is getting your shipyard and finding oil. Then we have ships and naval missions, crews and equipments, level 1, 2, and 3 shipyard tips, and finally, rewards from the naval missions. To make it easier to navigate, I've made shortcuts to the different chapters in the description of the video, so you can skip to the parts relevant to you. However, if you don't know a lot about how the shipyard works, I strongly suggest sticking around through the first three chapters. Chapter 1. Getting your shipyard and finding oil. The garrison shipyard was introduced in order to make you able to go back to the Tanan jungle, where your adventure started when you first went through the dark portal at the release of the expansion. Once you upgraded your garrison to level 3, a quest will pop up telling you to meet up with your faction leader who will tell you that the time has come for you to take the fight to the seas surrounding Draenor. After about an hour of questing, you will have your very own shipyard and a base in Tanan jungle from which you can start tearing the Iron Horde apart. The shipyard system works like the follower system, where you can send out ships on missions, bringing back gold, gear, and quest items for the legendary quest. I will go over these rewards later in the video. If you haven't done so already, I strongly suggest installing the Master Plan add-on, which works for both garrison missions and the shipyard missions. The interface is easier to understand, and you'll automatically get suggestions for which followers and ships to use for certain missions. In order to send ships out on missions, you'll need to gather some oil, which is the shipyard's version of garrison resources. You can obtain oil from the following missions or by questing in Tanan Jungle. There's a daily quest awarding you 600 oil upon completion, and the first time you complete the Tanan bonus objectives, you'll also be awarded 600 oil. The oil reward from the daily quest is more than enough to keep your ships out on the seas. So if you've done all of the bonus objectives once you come to Tanan Jungle, and you do the daily quest for a couple days, you shouldn't worry about having oil. If you want to, you can also buy the blueprint oil rig from the Hand of the Prophet or Vulgin's Headhunter's Quartermasters when reaching reward. This unlocks a daily naval mission rewarding 200 oil. Chapter 2. Ships and Naval Missions. Once you've completed the in-game introduction to your shipyard and you've gathered some oil, you can start making some ships. Like the follower system, each naval mission has some threats that should be countered in order to increase your chance of completing the mission successfully. The threats from the missions can be countered in different ways, the main one being using the correct type of ship. There are 5 types of ships that you can build. The transport count as land objectives, the destroyer count as submarines, the battleships count as destroyers, the carriers count as battleships, and the submarines count as carriers. Apart from these ships, you can also get a ship called the Awakener, which counts both as a submarine but also as a battleship. To get this ship, you'll need to be exalted with the Order of the Awakened. All of the ships, with the exception of the Awakener, can be made from your shipyard. The resource costs are listed on the screen. The ships you get comes in 3 different qualities: Common, Rare, and Epic. When building a ship, there's a chance that it's instantly upgraded to either Rare or Epic, but if it isn't, you can level them up by yourself by completing missions. To upgrade from Common to Rare, the ship needs 5,000 experience, and from Rare to Epic, 40,000 experience. It's a good idea to level up your ships, since you unlock equipment slots when upgrading from Common to Rare and again from Rare to Epic. And it's obviously better to have an Epic ship, since they have space for 2 equipments. You won't have access to all of the 5 types of ships right away, so you need to progress in the shipyard questline to unlock them all. There are currently 5 types of missions that you can go on. With few threats to counter and a relatively short mission time, training missions reward experience for your ships and is useful when you want to level up your ships. The combat missions takes a bit longer than training missions, but also gives you more experience, and maybe even epic items. The blockade missions prevent players from doing other missions in the blocked zone, so in order to unlock this zone, you'll need to defeat the blockade. Then there's bonus missions. When completed, this gives an area buff that affects an area on your sea map. You can get 5 different types of buffs, from extra gold gained on missions to increased success rate, etc. Then you have legendary missions. When doing the legendary questline, these missions will appear. Successful completion of these missions allow you to progress in the questline or gives you quest items such as Abrogator Stone. If you fail to succeed a naval mission, there's a chance that your returning ships are destroyed, removing them from your naval fleet. This is obviously annoying since you'll have to use time and resources to create another ship, and because the ship will use all of its equipment. It's therefore important to make sure that you have a good chance of completing the mission successfully. Chapter 3. Crews and Equipment. When building a new ship, it will automatically receive a random crew. Depending on which crew your ship gets, your ship will get one of the following buffs. For human and undead, you'll get increased success on missions. Draenog and Orc crews counters dense fog or icy water. Pandarian crews increases success on long missions. Murloc crews counters land objectives. Night Elf or Blood Elf reduces mission time by 50%. Gnomish or Troll crews recovers naval equipment from successful missions. Worgen and Tauren crews increases experience gained from missions for all ships by 50%. And finally, you have the Dwarven or Goblin crew, where you'll get increased gold gained from missions by 100%. If you have the Awakener ship, it will always get the Arakoa crew, which counters battleships. If you're unsatisfied with the crew of your ship, you'll have to decommission your ship and build a new one, since the crew is permanent. Even though your different ships has a natural threat counter, it's often not enough since the different missions have a lot of different threats. A bunch of the threats can only be countered through equipment. The Bilge Pump counters stormy weather. Blast Furnace counters swift. The Fullsmoke Launcher counters first strike. The Ghostly Spyglass counters cursed crews. The Gyroscopic Internal Stabilizer counters chaotic whirlpools. The Ice Cutter counters icy water. High Intensity Fog Lights counters dense fog. Trained Shark Tanks counters mine layers. And the True Iron Rudder counters evasive. From the start, you'll only have the Blast Furnace available to you as a reward from equipping our fleet quest. The rest of the equipment is obtained by killing elites in Tanakh Jungle. There's also a bunch of equipment that increases the success chance of missions. These items are obtained when a ship is upgraded from common to rare or from rare to epic, but you're not guaranteed to get any of the equipment, since it's random if you get it or not. If you're lucky, you can get the following equipment. The Armor Reserves increases success chance when in a party with a battleship. The Automated Sky Scanner increases the success chance when in a party with a carrier. The Q-43 Noisemaker Mines increases success chance when in a party with a submarine. Extra Quarters increases success chance when in a party with a transport. And finally, you have the Sonic Amplification Field, which increases the success chance when in a party with a destroyer. The last category of equipment is the Tuskar Fishing Net, which makes sure your ships bring back fish when on a mission, and the Unsinkable Equipment, which makes sure that your ship doesn't get destroyed when it fails to succeed a mission. These two items are obtained by getting to Honored and Reward with the Hand of the Prophet or Vol'jin's Headhunters. Chapter 4. The Level 1 Shipyard. When the tutorial is over, you'll have a transport and a destroyer at your command. In all, you have room for 6 ships, and so I advise you to make 2 additional destroyers, so you have 3 destroyers and 1 transport ship in total. The remaining 2 slots should be used for battleships once you unlock these. Your main focus when you'll have a Level 1 shipyard is to complete 15 naval missions, which can be done within a week depending on how much you play. While the crew of your ships are fighting for their lives, you should make sure you get friendly with the Hand of the Prophet or Vol'jin's Headhunters in order to complete I Sunk Your Battleship, so that you can buy blueprints for a battleship. When you got these plans, make 2 battleships so that you have 1 transport, 3 destroyers, and 2 battleships. If you're not going to farm for the battle blueprints right away, I suggest having 2 transports and 4 destroyers. I also suggest that you start farming for equipment blueprints so that you have a diverse fleet that can counter as many threats as possible. I personally dislike the equipment giving you increased success chances, and during level 1 you should swap out these for threat counters as they boost your chances more than the other equipment. If you started off by having 4 destroyers and 2 transports, you should decommission one of each type after getting the battleship blueprints. When decommissioning, take a look at the different crews on your ships. You want to keep the ships with human or undead crews and Pandarian crews, as these give you increased success rate so that you don't need to use an equipment slot for this later. If you have a Dwarven or Goblin crew, I would always keep it and make sure it only goes out on missions with a success rate above 90%, since it will increase your gold gain by 100%. This is so useful when you get a treasure mission awarding 2,000 gold and you get 4,000 instead. Some people suggest decommissioning ships of common quality and make new ones in the hope that they will be upgraded instantly. I've never really done that since I prefer using my garrison resources elsewhere. Once you've done 15 naval missions, you need 1,000 garrison resources and 1,000 gold to upgrade to a level 2 shipyard. Chapter 5, the level 2 shipyard. When upgrading your fleet from level 1 to 2, you'll receive the blueprints for submarines, and you'll now be able to have 8 ships. I recommend having the following setup: 1 transport, 1 submarine, 3 destroyers, and 3 battleships. Depending on the equipment and the crews you have on your current ships, I suggest farming blueprints for equipment and upgrading your ships until you can counter all threats. This way you'll have a diverse fleet that should have high chances of a safe return from missions. As for level 1, I suggest keeping all ships with Dwarven or Goblin crews to get the gold boost. You should also consider farming reputation for the Hand of the Prophet or Walgian Headhunters. Besides from that, level 2 is all about upgrading your fleet and completing a bunch of missions. In order to unlock the level 3 shipyard, you'll need to complete 25 naval missions, have 2,500 gold and 2,500 garrison resources. Chapter 6, the level 3 shipyard. Once you reach level 3, you can have 10 ships at a time. From your shipyard upgrade quest, you'll get the blueprints for the carrier, which is now useful. I suggest having the following setup: 1 transport, 1 carrier, 2 submarines, 2 destroyers, and 3 battleships. I also suggest having the Abaker, which counts as both a carrier and a destroyer. If you don't mind decommissioning a couple of ships, I also suggest that you make new destroyers until you get the Murloc crew, as it counters land objectives. You should upgrade your fleet as quickly as possible, keeping the chances of success on at least 80%, and start securing the ships that are most precious to you with an unsinkable equipment. Depending on your luck, I suggest getting at least one ship with a Dwarven or Goblin crew, as it gives you 100% extra gold gained from gold rewarding missions. Focus on having as many threat counters as possible, but remember that equipment which increases success chances are also now useful when going for rare missions. And now we're finally here. Chapter 7, the rewards from naval missions. Completing naval missions can prove to be worth your while, and once you set up a decent shipyard, you don't really have to do anything but grinding oil every once in a while. Just like the garrison missions, it's a great way to earn passive gold and gear. 4 treasure missions currently rewards an Iron Fleet treasure chest, containing a piece of armor from the Hellfire Citadel raid cell, while a bunch of other missions gives you baleful armor and sometimes even heirloom items. You can also get Apex's crystal rewards ranging from 2,000 to 5,000 each, or match 4 professions. Apart from that, there are 10 treasure missions that gives you gold, the best one being Blood, Gold and Regret mission, giving you 2,000 gold. If you have the gold boost crew, you'll get 4,000 gold, which is pretty damn good considering you just had to click one button. As of patch 6.2, you can earn the Mudback River Beast from a treasure mission, as well as the Left Shark Companion. There's also a mission giving you the Waterlocked Manifest, which allows you to get the Black Auction House by your garrison, as well as missions for your legendary questline. And that was pretty much all I had to say about the shipyard system. At the end of the day, the shipyard system gives you something to do, and it's pretty straightforward, Once you've set up your shipyard and completed the legendary quests involving your shipyard, you should head back and start earning some passive gold. I hope you find the information useful. Thank you for watching as always, and have a good one.